you.
It's been a little while.
Yeah.
Well,
everything will be
actually,
in this
room. I came to the board meeting.
Oh, yes, you're at the board meeting. Yeah.
I think when I called Captain, I kept my distance. I don't know what's over there. And then you guys, they hung around afterwards. So, all good.
Let me get my name tag.
Yep, Kathy Brister.
Hi, Nydia.
Good morning, Kathy.
How are you?
I'm doing very well.
Thank you. Good morning.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to tell me your name again.
Dana.
Dana, we met. You were at Welcome, right? Did you work
on her? I have in the past.
I don't think she did this last year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't think so.
You look familiar. I think we've met at some point.
I'm sure that you have.
Oh, the accelerator.
Good morning. My name is Richard Griffiths. I'm a Georgia First Amendment Foundation board member. And I'd like to welcome everybody to the 32nd Bar, Media, and Judiciary Conference. It's the third year that the conference is presented with the organizational support of the foundation. This conference was originally conceived by some judges and journalists as a way to get real conversations going between those justices and journalists and lawyers that don't always see eye to eye. The goal was to help all three groups better understand the others, their motivations, and also the political, judicial, and legal challenges they face and the state of Georgia faces. We have a really terrific program for the day. For the full rundown, you can go to the QR code or type in the bit.ly and get the rundown. You can get the bios, and you can get the additional supplemental materials, which there's quite a bit. We will have a working lunch today, and we'll let you know when those box lunches are in, so you can go get yours before all of the vegetarian ones or the ones with extra mustard disappear. I also want to remind everybody that there will be a reception at the end of the day, a good opportunity for some networking, good opportunity to meet the organizers and tell us what we should do better for next year, and your fellow participants. My big job today is going to try to keep the trains running on time and trying to make sure we are keeping somewhat close to the schedule, particularly around lunchtime. We've got a taping with WABE, and so we need to be really precise about that time. And so if we ask you to get back to your seats, please get back to your seats. Now I want to talk about the sponsors whose contributions go so far as to support this conference. The names are now on the screen: the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, CNN, big sponsor, the State Bar of Georgia, which gives us enormous support in setting up this conference, and the space, and your parking. So thanks very much to the State Bar and to Jones Day. And you see the other many generous sponsors on that list. This conference would not have been pulled together if it was not for the tireless work of the volunteers that you see on the screen. It's a lot of volunteers. A lot of hard work goes into this conference. I want to especially thank Peter Canfield from Jones Day, who patiently guides this committee through the preparation of this event. Now we'll turn to the kickoff panel of the conference.
Oh, yeah, yeah. My brother. Is that right? So here it was a global trade panel discussion in part of Georgia, investments are
I don't know if it's a
I hope you're all enjoying that delicious lunch. Mine was actually really good. We're going to start here now on the next panel with Chris Joyner moderating and describing his investigative work for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution that turned into the book, The Death Sentences of Clarence Henderson. Take it away, Chris.
Thank you very much. Again, I'm Chris Joyner. I'm an investigative reporter with the Atlanta Journal-Constitution and the author of the book, The Three Death Sentences of Clarence Henderson. With me today is Herb Cranford, Jr., who is district attorney for the Coweta Judicial Circuit, which includes Carroll, Coweta, Heard, Meriwether, and Troop counties. Herb was born and raised in Coweta County and is a third-generation prosecutor, his father and grandfather both having served as Solicitor General in Coweta County. And also with me is Brandon Henderson, who is the great-grandson of Clarence Henderson, who is the main character in the book. Brandon grew up in Decatur and in Stone Mountain, graduating from Redan High School. At Fort Valley State University, he studied criminal justice with a concentration in forensics, which is something I only just found out about, which is kind of fascinating given the topic of my book, which rests a lot on sort of the birth of forensics investigations. After receiving his degree, he considered a career in forensic science with the GBI, but ended up working in other jobs outside the field. Now he is working in our new homegrown industry of motion pictures as an actor. I appreciate everybody being here. I'll give you a little bit of background. Clarence Henderson was a sharecropper, a black man living in Carroll County in the 1940s. He was accused of the 1948 murder of a young man named Carl Buddy Stevens, or Carl Stevens Jr., known as Buddy, and was tried and convicted three times on those charges. Each time, those verdicts were overturned for lack of evidence by the Georgia Supreme Court. It's a notable story in a lot of ways because of when it took place during an intensely segregated period in Georgia's history. Clarence, being accused of having killed a white man, was tried and convicted three times by all white, all male juries, and entirely on circumstantial evidence. There was never anything linking him with the trial. With the murder, there were no witnesses that could place him in the scene, and he was in fact not even considered a suspect until about 18 months after the murder, and he was not by any means the first suspect that they tried to charge with the murder. So the story, I think in broad strokes, is about this period in American history following World War II, which I think is probably a poorly understood period of American history, because we have sort of a two-dimensional view of the late 40s, early 50s as being this boom time after World War II, where the middle class was expanding, and the suburbs were growing and communities very much like Carrollton, Georgia, where my book is set, are experiencing a tremendous period of change. But it was also a period where there were great social stresses. Black men in particular, having come back from serving their country in World War II, were anxious to push for a fair share of their American civil liberties. They were less likely to accept second-class citizenship than they had been prior to the war. And that was a real challenge to the system in Georgia, but also around the United States. So this gives you sort of like a broad sense of what the book is about. After the book was published, being an investigative journalist, my next thing was, well, what is sort of the next part of the story that I can look at? And one of the things that had sort of gnawed at me was that Clarence Henderson, after his third conviction was overturned by the state Supreme Court, was set to be tried for a fourth time on the same charge. And the prosecutor, instead of bringing it to trial, placed it on the dead docket, kept the charges on Henderson, but did not bring him to trial. And Henderson bonded out and lived the rest of his life with pending murder charges. Given the passage of time and our sort of broader understanding of the period, it occurred to me that the trial, the cases should be looked at again with fresh eyes, and I began contacting people in the judicial circuit where the charges were brought, and I'd actually like Herb, if you would pick it up from there, because I sent you a copy of the book, which you still have not read, right?
Sorry about that.
That's all right. It's, you know, this time. But Herb considered it, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but really part of your job, as much as prosecuting cases, to look at cases whether they should have been prosecuted or should be prosecuted at all. You know, dismissing charges is part of a district attorney's job as well. I'll let you pick it up from there.
Yeah, so again, been introduced. I'm Herb Cranford, VA of the Coweta Circuit. Like you said, that includes Carrollton and Carroll County. Just for some more background, currently we're have the fourth highest felony caseload out of 50 judicial circuits in Georgia. We have the number five population. My smallest county, Heard County's got 10,000 people, but we're the only circuit that has two counties with over 100,000 people. So now we're kind of in this interesting mix of metro Atlanta, but still some really rural areas. I think back in the 40s, it was just, you know, extremely rural. And the circuit's been the same, you know, that whole time. But, you know, being a third generation prosecutor, as Chris referenced, you know, I was brought up with a certain understanding of what the job is about, and I was not taught that it's about getting as many convictions as you can, or, you know, being a hammer looking for nails kind of mentality. It's about the pursuit of justice, and justice, like Chris said, and I think I put this in my motion in some fashion, is as much about getting convictions for people who break the law as it is dismissing cases when people don't break the law. More specifically, I view my job, I guess, as a more conservative perspective. I don't view my job as determining if someone actually didn't do it as much as, do I have the evidence to prove they did it beyond a reasonable doubt? I don't view it as engaging in, you know, supposition or opinion about what somebody's done. Either I can prove it or I can't. And looking at old cases, we're asked occasionally to look at an older case. It's typically by, you know, the mother of a defendant who got a substantial prison sentence, and as a mother, she doesn't think he did it, and wants somebody to look at it. And to be honest, most of those, you know, there's a record, there's a recent trial transcript. It doesn't take much time to look at that and kind of, you know, assess this was appropriate. I also have the benefit of my predecessor, Pete Scandalakis, was DA for 30 years. I started interning in the office in law school, hired as an ADA in 2012, became DA in 2018, and he ran the office well, and we had essentially the same perspective on the job. You know, so there aren't a lot of cases that I'm asked to look at from the last 30 years when he was DA that I have any concerns about. This obviously predates that. I think it was in the AJC, I exonerated the guy that was convicted in the early 80s of some rapes in LaGrange. But this is really the only other case that I've looked at where I thought you know, this needed to be addressed. Although Mr. Henderson is long deceased, I do think and thought there was value in to the community and to an extent, you know, the state in being willing to look at an older case to assess, you know, was justice done? Was it pursued? Can any justice be done currently regarding the case? But the fact that it was in dead docket status made that decision a little easier. It was not a closed case. And I don't know how many criminal lawyers we have in here. The dead docket is this kind of bizarre thing where, you know,
and not like a legal twilight zone.
Yeah, that's fair, I think. It's you know, where a case is docketed, in other words, it is formally charged in the case of a murder, indicted, it is on a court docket, meaning docketed. However, rather than, you know, pursue the case to trial or move to dismiss the case, you take it off active court calendar. So it's still docketed, but it's dead because it's not appearing on active calendars. We typically do that where somebody's been bench warrant for months and their bond has been forfeited. So we think we can prove the case, we think the case needs to be pursued, but the guy's in the wind and there's no point in keeping the case on calendar after calendar. That's typically when we do it. This was unusual in that they knew where Mr. Henderson was, obviously, but they, after three reversals, you know, I think it's logical to infer that they said we can't prove it, but maybe for various reasons, it was not tenable to the prosecutor at the time to move to dismiss it. So that made it a little easier because the case was actually still open. Looking at the three Supreme Court cases, I mean, without even looking at them, knowing it was reversed three times, made the decision pretty easy that, yeah, this deserved to be looked at. I mean, for the Supreme Court to reverse the conviction three different times kind of speaks for itself to say, you know, this maybe wasn't the strongest case.
And I have to say, from my perspective, in the context of the time, this was a court that would have been very conservative on race issues. It was all white, all male, state Supreme Court. And I found, and Herb, you can speak to this as a lawyer, I found those Supreme Court decisions to be, you know, very strong in how they were worded.
Yeah, I think I described in my motion it is unequivocal in their analysis. And since we got a bunch of lawyers, I wrote the citations down if y'all want to go look it up. It's 207 Georgia 206, 208 Georgia 73, and 209 Georgia 238. I think in the article in the AJC, y'all put a PDF of my motion if anybody wants to go read my analysis, which I tried to do in full. I think it deserved, you know, my fully articulating my thought process and analysis on not just why I'm moving the court to remove from dead docket and null process, but why I even decided to look at the case in the first place. But I think Chris is right, and maybe I won't go into that analysis at this point, but in looking at the fact the Supreme Court reversed it three times, it really wasn't a difficult decision to say, this is a case that needs to be looked at, and to the extent I can, give some analysis to the state of the evidence. And you know, Chris brought it to my attention. He sent me the book. I do intend to read the book. I don't have a lot of leisure reading time, unfortunately. But I made a point not to read it in doing the analysis, and I think I told Chris this. It was important to me to make the decision based on what's in the record, you know, what has been admitted in Georgia courts according to the rules of evidence, the law, et cetera. I didn't want to get into, things that might have been outside of that, as appropriate as that might be to put in a book and talk about. Then Chris put me in touch with Brandon. We had a Zoom meeting where he kind of formally asked me to review it, and he'll explain this, I'm sure, but you know, he would like his forefather's name to be cleared if that was possible, and I can understand that. And as I put in the motion, I think the citizens of the Coweta Circuit can relate to that. I think anybody in that position would want the current DA to look at their forefather's case to assess whether any clarity can be given to, you know, was this person rightfully convicted.
You know, one of the things that I think is interesting to think about historically is the role that the criminal justice system played during this period in American history as both an arm of segregationist politics and also the role it played in dismantling segregation. Both of these things are happening during this period. And as I was working on the book, and the researching and the writing, it kept coming back to me how traumatic the prosecution of Clarence Henderson was to him and to his family. You had a sharecropper with everything that entails, which is, you know, poverty, it's second-class citizenship, it's an inability to improve your station in life. Taking that person who is already in that position and charging them with murder is a double trauma for that family. One that even at the conclusion of my book is not addressed. So I want to throw it to you, Brandon, to talk about how, before the book came out, I'll say very quickly, I had some contact with Clarence's descendants as I was working on the book, but not Brandon, and not his mother and his sister, who I've gotten to know a little bit since the book came out, much to my pleasure, because they're great people. I got the sense that this was a story, this was a family story, which was told, but not in a tremendous amount of detail. And Brandon, I'll let you pick up, sort of tell me how that story was living in your family before the book.
Again, my name is Brandon Henderson. Thank you guys for having us. The story was first presented to myself after I got in trouble in school. I got in trouble in school under a situation where I kicked one of my classmates. And my mom sat me down and she was like, listen, trouble is easy to get into, but it's hard as hell to get out of. And she then went into the story. She elaborated on what transpired.
Brandon, can you come to my just a little question?
Absolutely. she went into the events that took place involving my great grandfather and his situation and how it ripped our family apart. As Chris just mentioned just recently, we are a close-knit family, a very close-knit family. We didn't have much while growing up. And the same can be said about my mom, also my grandma, my aunts, and cousins. And also to have that happen to our family, it just kind of like ripped a hole
in the entire like fabric of what we had already tried to establish and are trying to establish. So again, sat me down, talked to me about being wrongfully accused of something that you indeed didn't do, and the consequences that can come along with it. And it hit home, but she also warned me that I couldn't talk about it in public. I couldn't talk about it amongst my friends. I couldn't talk about it amongst my classmates because it was still an ongoing thing. We didn't know exactly who those parties were that were in favor of making sure, you know, my family's name was adjudicated, and of those who were the opposition to it as well. So we had to kind of like, I guess, hide in plain sight, if you will, and just kind of like move accordingly, and just to try to stay out of trouble as much as possible to make sure that, of course, you know exactly who you are, where you come from. You are a powerful person, and your powerful name comes behind you. However, you just can't do regular stuff. That regular stuff can get you into a whole bunch of trouble. So.
If I remember correctly, Brandon, wasn't it sort of put to you like, don't think that they won't come for you, that we've had this in our past.
I don't know, I can say all that. But of course, it was just more or less like, you know, I wasn't exempt. I wasn't exempt. I was a little black boy in the city of Decatur. I was surrounded by Caucasian Americans whose families were very affluential, whose families were very financially stable. And as I also stated, my family wasn't that. And so for me to be into trouble and to also stick out like a sore thumb, as some may say, it just wasn't a good look for myself. I had to kind of really, really make sure I walked a fine line. Make sure I stayed out of trouble as much as possible. So
how was the information transmitted to your family about what Clarence's story was? Because Clarence, my understanding is Clarence didn't talk about it a lot himself.
Not at all. Not at all. It was just more or less like, because from what I understand, through the years, as it's been broken down to me, he suffered a lot mentally from it. Of course, you know, he didn't disclose exactly what transpired while he was in custody. However, it was a lot. It was a burden on him. He just kind of like walked around with a hush mouth. Don't talk about it. Just, it happened. It just happened. But we just do not talk about it at all. Point blank and period. So, but for me to hear that, it just was like it hurt. It hurt a lot. To know that he was innocent, you know, from day one, my mom first presented the story to me, she told me emphatically, he didn't do it. I'm like, well, if he didn't do it, then why is he still sitting around being charged? Blah, blah, blah. And she was like, I mean, that's just how the system works. Hopefully one day it'll be, you know, different for him. So, yeah.
And one of the things that I think is important to understand in the story is that, of course, and for those of you that practice criminal law, it's not news to you, but, you know, the justice system worked very differently for defendants back in that time. And Herb, this is something you talk about in your motion about, you know, how essentially this couldn't happen today to Clarence Henderson the way it happened then, right?
I think what you're referencing is procedurally. Mm-hmm. So all the criminal lawyers in the room are familiar with the line of case law that started from the U.S. Supreme Court in the 70s. About sufficiency of evidence, and it essentially says if you're found not guilty for insufficient evidence, you can't be retried, but also if your case is reversed for insufficient evidence, you cannot be retried. That was also given retroactive application. So I wasn't familiar with the retroactive application aspect of it, just because that's been the law of the land since the 70s. But so I looked at it not just from the perspective of, was there sufficient evidence or not? That was pretty easy, given the Supreme Court had ruled on that three times. But I also said I'm moving to null process, not just for insufficient evidence, but on grounds of double jeopardy. The case had been reversed in the first trial for insufficient evidence, and according to, you know, the law of the United States since the 70s, it would have stopped there. And so I think that's what Chris is referring to, is under, you know, the modern interpretation of the Fifth Amendment Double Jeopardy Clause, like he wouldn't have been subject to retrial a second, third time. And you know, even if he was still alive and we thought we could prove it today, he would not be subject to retrial. So that is the law of the land, so I thought that was important to include as a basis as well.
I think anytime journalists bring up sort of like past injustices and talk about those issues and sort of how they echo how they echo today, we get feedback like you should just leave it in the past. Why are you digging up something from way back then? How's that supposed to help us today? But I do think that there is there's real value, and Herb touched on it as well, in taking a look at the failures of the past to help inform the present. I think it also means something to the community more broadly. I've heard from Brandon and other members of the Henderson family that the opportunity to clear Clarence's name and have those charges formally withdrawn is important. Brandon, I'd like you to, if you wouldn't mind, talk a little bit about sort of what that means today for the family.
I hate when you ask me this, because I honestly can't put it into words. One, how thankful I am for the moment and the opportunity, simply because everybody in this room has a last name. Everybody has, mother, father, regardless if they're in their family, or in their lives or not. But you don't want to hear anything bad about someone that represents your lineage, regardless of who they are and or how your relationship is with that person. So for my great-grandfather to always have this big gray cloud hanging over his name and also the family's legacy, it just does a lot. It does a lot. But in talking to my mom, while growing up, she always told me that this day would come. I didn't know it would be in this fashion. I don't see how these pretty faces, but definitely understand the importance of your family's legacy. And I talked to all three of my sons emphatically on a regular basis and expressed every day to them how important it is to walk in your life and be very proud of who you are and also the lineage in which you come from. So again, thank you. Thank you as well. I know this battle is not over, but just more or less, I'm very, very grateful to you as well.
I know it means something in the Henderson family because when the book came out, I got a phone call from Brandon's sister saying, who are you and why are you writing about my family?
I know this.
It's a real vital issue for the Henderson family, but I think more broadly, it's a vital issue for the community of Carrollton and Carroll County, and as Herb said, it's got implications for the state as well, because there's no expiration date on justice finding. I mean, that sounds a little corny, but it's true. It's when there is the opportunity to re-examine our failures, I do think that we can move and towards reconciliation.
Absolutely.
And I don't know, Herb, does that sound right to you?
Yeah, I mean, my perspective on that, even if there were no descendants of the Henderson family asking for this to be done, I think if I was considering doing this and y'all said, please don't, I probably would have deferred to your wishes. But my point is, even if there wasn't a family that this affected in this visceral, real way, I still think there would be value to the community in reviewing the case. Part of our office's mission statement, which I wrote, when I was pursuing the DA position in 2018, is maintaining the trust of the community we serve. And there are a lot of things that go into that. Transparency in how we do things as an office, the factors we consider in pursuing or not pursuing cases. And I think this is part of it. Being willing to look at a case, however old, to assess, was justice done, and is there something that can be done with it now to approach justice? And I think that obviously matters to the community in Carroll that believed Mr. Henderson was innocent, particularly the black community. There's also, you know, the victim family who was obviously traumatized by this. You know, somebody died. The one witness in the case was out on a date with the victim. She wasn't a listed victim in the case. They could have, you know, added felony charges for what she went through as well. They're, you know, very affected by this as well, you know, at the time, and it's extremely traumatic, obviously. And, you know, I think to have pursued a case against somebody where there was insufficient evidence, you know, they went through a trial three different times. I think, you know, there's reverberations there too. And, you know, looking at it and closing the case with more clarity to some extent, I think, serves everybody in the community. But given that there's still a DA's office pursuing charges for murder and things like that now, the community knowing we're an office that is willing to look at a case like this and try to get closer to a just resolution, I think will increase and maintain the community's trust that we're trying to do what's right. You know?
Yeah, I think the poor application of justice in a case like this is traumatic for victims, it's traumatic for defendants, and it's traumatic for the community at large. And I think it's okay to acknowledge and examine that when we think about, you know, where can we move towards reconciliation? What role can the justice system play in that? When I first started looking at this case, it was in the 1990s at my first newspaper job, which was in Carrollton. And there were people, this was a living memory for them. There were people that were, you know, young people when the trials occurred. And I had people waving me off of the case. This was, you know, the last trial was in 1952, and it wasn't dead docketed until 53. So that's a long time, but 45 years later, there were still people who were saying, you don't want to mess with this. It's too hurtful an issue in the community. And I've said this before, when I go do like book events in Carrollton, it is unlike when I do book events anywhere else, because they're like, I live on this street and it happened over here, and I have this private theory about what happened, and you know, so and so told my uncle that this happened. It is part of their community identity. And you know, thoughtfully addressing this, hopefully I did so in the book, but also in a public forum like a courtroom, I think is important, not just for the Henderson family, but for the broader community as well. And so certainly it's my hope that we're doing that going forward. And I suppose we should say, we haven't really said, but there is a motions hearing next week.
Yeah, March 2nd, and I guess I need to confirm, you know, if the judge wants to do it at 9 or later, but, you know, we could have, I could have filed this motion, given it to the judge, it'd probably be signed in chambers or something, you know. It was important to me that we do it out in the open. We didn't have names of descendants of the victims' families. And so the AJC, thankfully, and the local paper in Carrollton, the Times Georgian, were willing to publicize that I had agreed to review the case. And part of that story was I would like to get input from the descendants of the victims to see what they had to say about this. And if they wanted to, you know, if I ultimately decided to move to dismiss the case, if they wanted to oppose that, I thought they had a right to do that. I mean, victims' rights are now in the Georgia Constitution. That was very important to me. And just recently, in the last couple weeks, a descendant of the deceased it was his aunt's descendants, if I understand it correctly, kind of heard about it. They live in Carrollton, just didn't see the paper, and reached out to me. I told them about the hearing date and told them they have a right to not only be there, it's open to the public, anybody in the community can be there, but they specifically have a right to be heard. They can write a statement, we can put it in the court record, they can make a statement. And I made it very clear expressly to them that if they wanted to criticize my decision, like they should, you know. This whole case affected them, and the way it was resolved with reversals affected them, and they deserve to be there. Yeah,
it's generationally unsettled for that family as
right.
well.
And you know, and I don't necessarily think they're taking a position. They're certain Mr. Henderson did it or something, but you know, they were affected by this, and I think they have a right to be heard as well. Now, in talking to them, I don't think they're going to take the position they're opposed to it. I think they're being very thoughtful about it as well. And I think that's great. They're referring to it. They're talking about it in a similar way, and I hope it's okay that I'm kind of speaking for them in a certain sense. A similar way in terms of giving closure to their family as well about it. This affected a lot of people, I think, like we're talking about, I mean, making a formal decision about the case is going to be a good thing for their families, the Henderson family, but I think also the community generally. Even if, you know, a few people disagree with where I came down on it, which again, to be clear, is, you know, it's not my job to engage in supposition about, you know, what I think happened, or if I had to bet on it, what do I think, you know. My job is to assess, is there evidence to prove a person committed a crime beyond a reasonable doubt? In this case, there is not that evidence. You know, the Supreme Court came to that conclusion 3 times. I think it's appropriate that I, in my position as DA, say that clearly today.
Yeah, and not only was our cases like this, and there are many of them, injustices for the people who were wrongly prosecuted, but they're injustices for the victims and their families as well, because for historical reasons, in the case of Clarence Henderson's charges, the investigation was sort of fatally flawed from the very beginning, and there was never a legitimate opportunity to find who really killed Buddy Stevens. Instead, what the family was drugged through, and Buddy Stevens' girlfriend at the time and her family were drugged through, was 3 trials where they had to go through that horror again and again, only to see those convictions overturned. And if the system wasn't at that time so bent towards the prosecution of a black man for this crime, then you know they would have had a shot at justice, but they didn't. So I do think that there is some healing that can happen for those descendants as well. I'm really interested to hear the statement from Buddy Stevens' cousins, because he was an only child and his parents had passed away. So I was unable to find people who were directly related. So I'm of course interested to hear how they feel about it as well.
And I think it's probably worth pointing out, similarly, I was told they didn't talk about it as a family. It was a traumatic, bad thing that happened in their family, and they didn't talk about it. It may be that some older generations did read about it in the paper and chose not to reach out. It was somebody, you know, closer to my age that chose to reach out and speak to her brother and father and get them to communicate with us. So, I think the closer you are to trauma, I think. I see it in murder victim families, rape victim families. You know, they generally don't want to talk about it. They generally don't want to have to come to court and relive this experience. You know, they generally don't want to talk to the media about this awful thing that happened to them, you know. And so, you know, maybe now that, that a lot of years have gone by, there's some younger generations, you know, who you know, want to participate and get some closure, you know.
We're running, yeah, please.
Come to the microphone, please.
Yeah, we have a little bit of time. We'll take a couple of questions if anybody's interested.
Chris, in a nutshell, could you tell us what the circumstances of the crime were and what the evidence was that was presented?
I can do this fairly efficiently. So there had been, during the summer and fall of 1948, a serial rapist in Carroll County who had been attacking young couples in sort of lover's lane situations. And the assailant would use a gun to scare off the boy and then sexually assault the girl. That was the case with Buddy Stevens and his date man Turner on the night in October 1948. The main difference being that Buddy was a returning war veteran and didn't scare off, and instead fought with the man and was shot to death. Nan escaped on foot, but took well over an hour before police were able to find Buddy Stevens' body because she wasn't sure which direction she had run. The case sort of languished for 18 months because she didn't get a good look at the guy. And there were, in fact, in all the prior assaults, there was no good description of the assailant because he was always masked, using a flashlight to hide his identity, changing his voice, according to some people. Clarence Henderson was connected to the case because the police found a gun in a pawn shop in Atlanta that had been connected to an earlier attack. It had been stolen off an earlier victim. And the problem with it was that it was a .38 revolver, and the round taken from Buddy Stevens was a 9mm. And at the time, the Fulton County Crime Lab went through a process where they believed that you could make a 9mm round chamber up in a .38 revolver, and they believed they could connect the gun to the crime, and they believed that through a series of exchanges they could connect the gun to Clarence Henderson for a narrow window when he might have been able to have committed the crime. In the course of the trials, both the forensics evidence and the chain of custody of the gun were challenged in ways that, in my opinion, would not have led to a verdict of guilty in a modern courtroom. So that gives you sort of the broad strokes. Of course, I go into painful detail in the book about it. So.
Yeah, and I think to add to that a little bit, the Supreme Court kind of accepted as a given that the bullet was fired from the gun in question, and the gun in question was connectable to Mr. Henderson. Right? You know, they kind of accepted that, and they said, even given that, there is insufficient evidence because it was a circumstantial case. There's only one eyewitness. The extent of her ability to identify the assailant was he sounded like a black person, and she said that the flashlight hit his hand at some point, and she believed his skin was that of a black person.
Right, that was only in the second trial, I believe, when she said that. She became more convinced over the course of the trials.
Yeah, and so... you know, even accepting that, you know, that as a premise, the Supreme Court said, you know, insofar as they connected the defendant with the homicide, they authorized the jury to find that on the night of the killing, the defendant owned the pistol from which the bullets were fired that killed the deceased. And, you know, it was the same sufficiency of evidence analysis that exists today. You have to, you know, preclude any other reasonable possibility. And they make the finding three different times. They did not preclude the reasonable possibility that someone else could have done this.
I think we're going to have to wrap up. I will be here. I know I'm happy to take questions afterwards, but I think we do need to kind of keep on schedule again. I thank you all for sitting here and listening. I will say I was invited to bring copies of the book, so I do have copies of the book, which I'm happy to sell and sign if you're interested. And Brandon said that he would sign books as well. Have to have an actual Clarence Henderson to send.
Thank you. So we have about 7 minutes here for a quick break, and then we'll be back to do a taping of WABE's Political Rewind. Excuse me. Breakfast. Ooh, ooh.
Hey, how you doing? Good to see you.
Doing all right?
Good.
Really, how are we doing?
Well.
Yeah. What a fantastic day. A few items before we head to the reception. I want to again thank our sponsors. In particular, again, I want to thank the bar who make this space available to us, who give us so much support through the year. And again, for that fabulous parking. When you have the opportunity on your way out, please thank them. I also want to thank the planning committee members that have worked so hard to pull this event together. And there's one name at the top of the list there I want to thank. It's written in small type, so I've blown it up just a little bit. Peter Canfield is our planning committee chair. The first conference was in 1989. We skipped a couple of years, one very early, and then one after 9/11. But guiding this effort through the last 30 years, 30 conferences, has been Peter Canfield. Love, corralling plenty of type A lawyers, judges, and journalists, getting them on a committee, getting them to work together towards a program that educates, informs, and challenges. We owe Peter a huge debt of gratitude. Please step up here for a moment.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go get a drink.
I just want to thank you, Lance, for helping us launch that podcast.